But before I start, I thought I'd have a little bit of fun and teach you the right move for this portion. It's this tie. This is a very important tie to my dad. I wore it on every Michigan Ohio State rivalry day. He was dressed in blue and maize all the way down, and just had a ball, just antagonizing anybody he could. So, Dad, for you, happy to get it one last time. So, we'll keep this up here so everybody remembers. So now that I've alienated probably half the audience, I would sincerely like to thank all of you again to come and honor the greatest man I've ever met. Of all the traits I remember the most about my dad is he had the biggest heart I've ever known. He was without fail committed to his family, his friends, swimmers, students, and anyone who needed his advice, his time, or a swift kick in the you-know-what. Don't get me wrong, everything he did because he really cared and unconditionally accepted everyone. He was also deeply committed to make sure that my mom, sister, and I had opportunities to experience life in many different levels and stages in life. Of course, my dad instilled a solid work ethic in my sister and myself, and through our schoolwork and labor and life, our jobs, and all of the things that we needed to be diligent about. But he always made sure that when he followed up those pieces of advice, that he always made sure that he said that we're not here for a long time, we're here for a good time. So some of the things, he may have said that to some of you, but Katie and I remember that very, very well. Sports were a big part of our life growing up as well. I mean, with all of his involvement in coaching and swimming, but he was actually there, for Katie and myself. He allowed us to participate in any sport we wanted to ever play in. Unfortunately, that turned my mom not just to a soccer mom. She was a soccer, baseball, softball, basketball, volleyball, and swimming mom. On top of that, she was an orchestra, band, 4-H, and cheerleading mom. Thanks for that, Dad. For the actual playing of sports, my dad was always there to support. Whether it was a coach of one of the teams that I played on, or a spectator at just about every game I ever played in. And he did this on top of all of the other things that all the speakers spoke about, which I just find amazing. It's like I remember countless hours of, hitting and fielding instruction both at home and at Bayreuth Fields over in Newark. He even made it possible for my friend and Tom England and I to skip school out of high school, come over here and get into the batting cages, which was kind of fun. So it was whatever it took. One time, and I say one time, he was even my pitching coach. When I was 16, I really wanted to make the traveling baseball team in Ohio. And I figured my best shot was to do that as a pitcher. I'm a lefty, I could throw reasonably hard, and had some good movement on my fastball, and had a decent curveball. So of course, my dad was right there to help him. So we went over to the Granville Fields one day, and after warming up, I went out to the mound. And even with my dad's terrible knees, he squatted down the plate. I threw one pitch. Fastball right down the pipe. Did I mention I had movement on my fastball? Well, the ball moved and did not end up in the webbing of my dad's glove, but into his palm. He fell on his back as I cracked a couple of bones in his hand. After he was done swearing, I helped him up, and he goes, "You're good, just throw it back." No, one pitch. Sports also permeated a lot of things in our house, too. Sunday was my dad's favorite day. It was his day off, his day to relax, his day to hang out with his family, his day to yell at the Browns or the Indians, depending on the season. And on a side note, it really is too bad that he didn't get to go to the Browns' perfect season parade. But, the further on Sundays, I remember all of us on the couch with the fat of buttered popcorn, my dad's staple food, us sitting there soaking up his knowledge on the finer points of how to be a diehard fan to losing Northern Ohio sports teams. But to get the true picture of the afternoon, you have to get my sister in the mix. So you imagine me sitting on one side, my sister sitting on the other, and here's my dad and I shoveling down popcorn like it's our last meal. And my sister, with her little dainty hands, she's going into the popcorn, she's having one piece at a time, because that's what little girls do. But about halfway through the vat of popcorn, my dad and I are like, "Dry." And, well, special power to not only find every kernel that had butter on them, but to extract them with NASA-type precision. So back to the kitchen you go and put more butter on it. So, you know, it was a very helpful insight. But really, the frustration and the bewildered look on his face was priceless. It was one of the very few times I ever saw him speechless. He would just sit there and stare at the bowl. Look at my sister. Stare at the bowl. And then he actually, you know, would maybe utter something, you know, really priceless, like, that's all we could get out. But beyond sports, my dad is also an avid lover of the arts. He was a seasoned ticket holder of the Broadway series in Columbus. So we were introduced to great theater performances and symphonies. He also loved to travel. He had great vacations as a family. From Florida to London, we were exposed to so much. Activities that I still love to do this day. He never lost his passions. He got to travel the world with my mom, some of their friends, places far off. He was only able to read comic books before then. And as I became an adult, he was still an important influence in my life, helping with my trials and tribulations, ensuring the good times as I went off to college. He loved to come over to IU for college games, watching me play club lacrosse, or coming into dad's weekends at my fraternity. He truly enjoyed hanging out with my fraternity brothers and sharing war stories from his own fraternity days and stuff you learn. Maybe repeated here. But my dad's relationship with my sister was truly special. Only one a dad and daughter could have. While my dad had a very strong exterior, he would let Katie play with his hair, and yes, he did have hair at some point, and create mohawks and ponytails and everything else that she wanted to do to him while he was, you know, passionately sat there. He always wanted to make sure that she was dressed in her Mary Janes and black dresses and you know, as a young girl should. But it was also, you know, whether snuggling with my dad on his infamous green chair, which is this green chair that lasted somewhere around 300 or 400 years, or dancing with him in her wedding. He was always the comforting support in her life. When it came, while he came off as preoccupied a lot when he was in his chair, Piper Reese Sawyer, that's Katie's kids, always found their way into his lap, and it was easy to see how much joy he brought to my dad. He definitely was a good laugh whenever you were looking for it or not, and a lot of times it involved cartoon clipping or animals. One of my sister's funniest memories about our dad is our parents' dog, Rufus, this is after Murphy, got loose in the neighborhood. Now, while this dog loved our parents to no end, and he got, if he did get loose, he would thought that he didn't know us anymore. So anyway, Rufus found freedom and took full speed, he's running all over the neighborhood. And you have to understand the new neighborhood, yeah, there's lots of open green spaces, and he was just gone. As my sister got sighted and running towards a busier street, my dad went flying past her in the Honda Accord, not on the street. He was going to go get that dog and lure it back into the car where the dog loved to go for car rides. And after a while, Rufus comes tearing around, you know, one of the bushes, and there's my dad right behind him in the Honda Accord going four-wheeling and chasing the dog down. But, you know, Dad did love animals to no end, and, you know, I'm sure that as soon as he got to heaven, God said, yep, you're in charge of the puppies. But another thing that really says who my dad was he had this collection of VHS videotapes. Our dad sure did love his shows, and I think, we're pretty sure he kept kind of Panasonic in years for business for an additional 10 years. With his purchases of VHS tapes. Not to mention, you actually think that Perry Mason is still alive. Switching to a DVR was a major feat for him. However, the space was never enough when there was more than one show that could be recorded at one time. So it was always a little interesting around saying, we have to watch this because I've got to tape this. But the greatest accomplishment, that didn't throw anything away, so he still has a functioning 8-track tape player. Okay, so this is his prize obsession because he had countless tapes to go with it. So how does one modernize an 8-track, player? Well, you take one son-in-law, 3 trips to Radio Shack, and some trickery, and boom, you have a Bang Olufsen Bluetooth speaker system playing the greatest hits of the 50s, which is his favorite era. And, just modern technology, I can tell you it's hard on some, but my dad is no exception. Well, he had a lot of techy toys. He never, we're not sure if he ever leveraged them to their full potential. The laptop was definitely a foe unless he got into his was always there in difficult times. It didn't matter whether it was a big problem or a small one. He was there to provide support and full engagement, as many of you spoke about before today. Sometimes the advice was just as simple as one of his catchphrases at home: be like a duck and let it just slide off your back, or control what you can control. In many cases, life can just be that simple. Additionally, he was always there to celebrate the small victories as well as the big milestones, and always was there with a big smile on his face, as you all remember, that only a proud father can have. He was also a loving grandfather. He was very proud of his 5 grandchildren. He was a consummate teacher, whether it was giving advice, relaying life stories to all of them, tutoring my son Brooks, or reading endless books to Katie's youngest son, Sawyer. Now, if there was an injustice, look out, kids. Some of you would know this, but this is where he really did shine. He was very careful to gather all the facts on both sides and make every effort to see that justice was upheld. Some of you mentioned that, you know, at work, it didn't matter if the student was right, if the teacher was wrong, or if the teacher was right, the administration was wrong, or at home, if you may have, and I repeat, may have said something stupid to your mother. He focused every bit of his energy on making the hard matter and to fairly resolve the issue. This, ladies and gentlemen, is something I call integrity, and something that my dad had no shortage of and could always be counted on. It wasn't a problem he couldn't solve or a direction he couldn't give. Whether you wanted the answer or not, his advice was always going to be the right thing to do, and frankly, you knew it. And on a quick aside, going back to something somebody else had said, one of the interesting things about my dad is he had this eidemic memory, and it's fascinating to me to this day. I mean, we didn't have Google growing up, we had my dad. He'd just sit around and say, hey dad, back in 2 years ago on this date, and we were doing this, where were we, and who were we with, and there was the information just right there in front of him. You remember just about every student here, whether you were in trouble or not, every fact he encountered or read, it was unreal. However, did any of you ever start an argument with my dad that involved facts? Did you know you were going to lose before you ever began? Just saying. But to finalize the points I just mentioned, I remember one of my famous meet and greets on High Street in Columbus, which is a strip of bars down by Ohio State's campus. It's 2:00 in the morning, and White Castle was calling to me and my friends. When we were standing in line at the door, I would always strike up a conversation just to try and find out where they went to high school. I got it. Somebody went to Worthington, that's where the fun began. So I'd always ask him, it's like, well, what happened? Oh, I was on the West. Oh, you ever have me run into Sterling outdoors? Oh, yes, this kid says. Quite a few. And so what this kid did was the bravest thing I've ever heard of in my life. He goes down to the office, which is, you know, the long walk of death down these hallways. And he goes into my dad's office and no one's in there. So he decides that he's going to sit in the big comfortable chair behind the intimidating desk and wait for my dad. He can put his feet up on the desk, which I thought was a special addition. But anyway, so when my dad arrived in the office, he noticed that, you know, this is a little odd. It's a very brave student sitting in the chair, and he calmly turned around and sat into what I refer as called the trouble chair. I don't know if you guys remember this. It was this god-awful, ancient, terrible, but comfortable green vinyl chair that was specially fit for miscreants and angels alike. Your level of comfort definitely fit the reason you were there. And as my dad was sitting there in the trouble chair, the kid goes, "So, Mr. Apthorpe, what seems to be the problem today?" Definitely one of my dad's catchphrases. So my dad sat there just trying not to burst into laughter. But he did remain stoic, and he responded and goes, "Do you mind if we switch chairs? I think we'll have a more productive conversation that way." "Sure," says the kid. And the conversation ensued between he and I. And I asked him finally what happened. He goes, "Oh, I got suspended." Basically, he told me he mouthed off to a teacher, which wasn't one of his finer points, but he deserved what he said. But the really interesting thing, and what I learned to see from an insider's point of view looking outside, was this kid literally went on to say, he goes, "Well, Sterling saved my life." And he goes, "That's why I'm here in college." And I said, he went on to say, and said before, he was really tough, but he was really fair. My name is Sterling Treat Apthorpe III. This kid lost it. It was great. The look on his face was priceless. He sat down and laughed for a good half an hour as we ate that terrible White Castle. So on the next day, with Dad having a memory that he did, I asked my dad, do you remember him? He goes, well, not only did my dad remember his full name, his approximate GPA, he did graduate, kind of, but informed me this kid had a terrible home life, was constantly in my dad's office for minor errors of judgment, parents didn't care about him, had five older brothers who were in prison, not jail, but prison. I asked him, I asked my dad when he decided to give extra attention to this kid. And he simply responded, because he asked. And I think that story sums up my dad pretty well, because it just shows that he had a place in his heart for everyone. And see, you see, in my eyes, to become someone like my father, you must see life as something much larger than yourself. Calling that for him lasted a lifetime and a legacy that will last forever. Whether it was being a great husband, father, teacher, coach, administrator, philanthropist, or friend, he did it all with unwavering fervor, grace, and dignity. So I have one final request before I bring up my mom. Would everyone stand up for a minute? If you wouldn't mind, I'd like you all to put your hands together for my father to help honor and celebrate his life. Several Cleveland Browns players being attendance.